Okay, good afternoon, friends. I wish you, some part of people, some part of the country, they are celebrating New Year, Baisakhi, but it's a lockdown New Year. Anyway, nevertheless, I wish you all a happy New Year. Okay, yeah, welcome to our Karnataka ENT Hospital Innovative Masterclass. Okay, this is an initiative of Karnataka ENT Hospital, and it's a center and the Champions Educational and Medical Society of Chitradurga, Karnataka, India. Okay, please note our future classes also. Okay, I would like to have all of you for our future classes also. Okay, look forward to have you here. Okay. Welcome all. Okay, so I'm going to start with part one, very, very basics. That is normal imaging anatomy of the temporal bone. Okay, yeah. To start with, I would like to, you know, pay my tributes to all those healthcare workers and doctors who gave up their lives while fighting this COVID-19. So we will remember them. They are in our prayers. God bless their souls. And also, I pray God gives enough courage, strength to their families who have lost them. Okay? We'll keep praying. Okay? Yeah. So before I start, I would like to dedicate this, my presentation, to my alma maters, the institutions where I got educated. The first is JJ Medical College, Davangere, where I did my undergraduation. And next, Postgraduate Institute of Medical Education and Research Center, Chandigarh. It's also known as shortly as PGI, Chandigarh. Okay, yeah, I dedicate my talk to them, this thing. Okay, some instructions before I start. Your audio is muted, okay? So I'm sure definitely you'll have some doubts, but please, note it down. Okay, so we will have question and answer session in the end. I will unmute all of you. Okay, we can talk to each other in the end. Okay, so if you have doubts, so what to do? If you have questions, please write to me. Okay, either email or WhatsApp me. Please note down my WhatsApp number and email. You can write it down. Okay, so what you do is, if you have any doubt, you'll note the heading of the slide, which slide you have doubt. Okay, the title of the slide, and also note the slide number. Okay, you note that slide number, then you can write to me. Okay, then I will clarify your details. Okay, I will certainly do that. Okay, this is an interactive session. I would like to clarify all your doubts. Okay, so you may ask me, why radiology for us ENT surgeon? See, we all have good radiology friends. We must have, you know. So all the radiologists, they are like our, you know, second degree or first degree professional relatives. You know, we should never compete with them. Rather, we should have a complementary relationship with them. We should help each other. We should always discuss with them about your patients, about your films and everything. But nevertheless, still, if you have first-hand knowledge of radiological aspects of your patient, the surgery you're dealing with, the anatomy you're dealing with, you're better prepared. Because when you master radiological aspects of particular disease, particular anatomy, you're also going to master the anatomy of that region. Okay. Surgery is all about, you know, reconstruction, destruction, modification of anatomy. So to be a good surgeon, first you need to be a good anatomist first. Okay. And radiology will also give you an optimum diagnosis so that you can direct your treatment appropriately. And also you can plan your surgery. Radiology actually will give you a sort of pathway to surgery. Okay. And also radiology will help you to minimize the complications. If there's any anatomical variations of pathology, you can notice them beforehand and you can address them. So remember that. And also, radiology will help you to maximize your results. Okay. See, I'll tell you, for example, either endoscopic sinus surgery or some of the ear surgeries, my success is mainly because of my radiological knowledge. I'm telling you, I'm not boasting. I have one of the best results with endoscopic sinus surgery. That came mainly because of my understanding of CT, paranasal sinus, CT scan. So that's how we achieve better results. So you may ask me, how many surgeries are there in otology? Why should we learn radiological anatomy of otology? You may not believe there are nearly 300 types of otological surgeries. But how many actually we do? We may be doing just 10, 15 surgeries, that's all. But if you want to be a good otologist, and lateral skull based surgeon, you need to learn all those surgeries. And one thing can stand with you is radiological knowledge. Okay. So see, this is, I want to tell you at the beginning, a parable from history. So there was a great king in India called Akbar, and he had a very, very clever minister called Birbal. So one day Akbar asked him, the Birbal, so there are how many crows in the city? Birbal said, there are about 8 million crows. So, but other ministers didn't agree. They said, there are more than 8 million, there are about 10 million crows. Okay. But that's for that, Birbal said, they're all relatives of our crows who have come from outside. Then some minister said, no, there are less crows. But that he said, no, some of our crows have gone to other cities visiting their friends and relatives. Like that, otology also, we may not be doing some surgeries because we have not come across those surgeries. We didn't get an opportunity, something like that. So I encourage all of you to take up otology as your prior choice, because otology is cream of ENT. I'll tell you. Okay, if you master otology, you're on top of the world. Okay, yeah, that's what I would like to convey today. So now, 1 minute, I will remove this screen so that I had floating meeting controls. Okay, yeah. So when you want to study temporal bone, HRCT temporal bone, which view? See, there is no single good view to study complete anatomy and all kind of pathology. For that matter, you need to master all views. Okay, you have to master axial view, you have to master coronal views, you have to master sagittal views. Okay, and you know, one particular view cannot describe anatomy of all the structures and all pathologies, because the temporal bone is one organ in the body, one part in the body which has maximum anatomical variations. So you can, as a otologist or ENT surgeon, you can be proud that when you're handling ear diseases, you're handling one particular region which has maximum anatomical variations in the body. So these are the three common views which we use routinely. Okay, but there are other 10 different views are there if you want to master everything. There is one Pushkal's view where, you know, we want to study the essence of lateral sensor canal, or there is, if you want to study particularly vestibular aqueduct, there is sagittal oblique reconstructions there. If you want to look at properly at the ossicles, there is molar tooth views there. Then also, if you want to study entire course of facial nerve and the cochlea, particularly for the cochlear implant, to look at the cochlear malformations or, you know, structure or measure length of the cochlea, then this particular view is there. Then you can also do a 3D reconstruction. See, that is the modern CT scan has provided so much advanced VHS. Okay. See, each and every semicircular canal can be individually studied with appropriate, views. So that is the advantage of latest CT scans. Okay. Yeah. Coming to the CT algorithm, now the latest CT scans, which are more than 16 slides, usually what they do is they take, the film, the sections only in an axial section, that is in orbitomyoidal plane, which is supposed to be parallel to the floor of the earth. Okay. And then what they do, they use the CT algorithm computer mechanism to reconstruct other coronal and sagittal and whichever view they required. So now, unlike the older CT scans, they don't have to put the patient in different positions and put the patient into a lot of discomfort and do this. Okay. Yeah, that is important with the latest this thing. And one more thing I do is when I want to study, I load the films into a software called Poros. Okay. I use a Mac platform, Mac computer, MacBook Pro. And this particular software helps me to read each individual films in a most detailed way. You must have come across this. There are many softwares like this. In that, since the Horos is good with Mac, I use Mac, and I will show you the advantages of Horos. See, this is Horos software. As you can see here, you can see like a movie. You can see, I'll just show you the hope you can all see this. And you can study in every anatomy in a continuity. That is how you master the anatomy and pathology with this Horos software. And also you can study in the different views. If you want to study the coronal view is there. Okay. And if you want to look at sagittal view, you can look at the sagittal view also in detail. So that is the beauty of Horos software. And it is free student edition or research edition. It's free for all. If you're using a Mac, use the Horos. I think for Windows also, there are many such platforms. You can use it, okay? So use whichever is convenient to you, okay? So, but I like Horos system, okay? Yeah, now this is one of the videos I'll show you how Horos depicts in detail, in continuity, entire anatomy. So that is what is more important, okay? So I hope all of you use this. Okay, now coming to this thing, I'm not going to teach you today any particular views, whether axial view, coronal view, sagittal view, or anything. Because before you want to study them in continuity and learn a system, you need to understand some basic anatomy of the radiological anatomy of the temporal bone. I'm going to teach you only those aspects today. I'm not going to deal with anything else. Okay. So now, one thing you need to understand first is the tip one, number one is the horizontal axis of the temporal bone. Okay, the temporal bone, you know, it is situated, it is the whole petrous part of the temporal bone, we can imagine it as a pyramid, as you can see here, the blue line, okay? And the base of the pyramid is towards the mastoid bone or parietal bone, yeah, okay? And the apex is towards the sphenoid bone, as you can see here, I hope all of you can see my mouse here, okay? And so the temporal bone, the axis is directed anteriorly, medially, okay? See, this is towards the anterior and medial towards the sphenoid here, okay? And also when you look at coronal section, if properly done coronal section, it also has, little bit, you know, inferiorly directed also like this, okay? So that we need to keep in mind when we study individual structures, okay? Yeah, that is important. So that is first horizontal axis of the temporal bone. And the second, the tubes and circles. See, there are many structures in the middle ear and mastoid, you know, which run in canals, various canals, okay? For example, facial, now it runs in a facial canal, internal carotid artery runs in a carotid canal, like this important structures. So these structures, depending on the plane of the CT scan, whether you're in the axial scan, coronal scan, or sagittal section, whichever plane they are, okay, if they're, see this, for example, carotid artery is in, it's in the horizontal plane, okay? If you take, if you look at it on a axial section, it will look like a tube, as you can see here, okay? And extraordinary canal is also horizontally oriented. If you look at in axial section, it will look like a tube. Remember this, tubes and circles. Whereas when you take a, you know, sections perpendicular to them, like as in sagittal section, the extraordinary canal becomes like a circle, okay? So tubes and circle phenomena, you should remember. Same thing happens with the semicircular canal also. Okay, I'll show you the superior canal. The topmost arch of the superior canal, it looks like a tube, as you can see here. Whereas the other arches, you know, two limbs of semicircular canal, they look like circles because this axial section is perpendicular to these both limbs of the anterior and posterior arch of the this thing, superior canal. So you should remember these tubes and circles phenomena. For various tubular structures, okay? And the third important point is the orientation of internal artery meatus and external artery meatus. As you can see here, the internal artery meatus as well as external artery meatus, they are parallel to each other. Remember, the both are parallel to each other, but the one difference is the internal artery meatus is at a higher level compared to the external artery meatus, as you can see here. For that matter, if you see these red lines, it is the floor of the internal artery meatus is exactly at the same level, whereas the roof of the external artery meatus. Remember this, okay? So this level, this particular plane is very, very important plane, particularly for me, okay? So what I look for in this particular plane is, one is we go from outside to inside. Important structure, this putum, okay? Our lateral aortic wall, okay? This is one of the first structures which get destroyed in cholesteatoma, okay? That you should remember. And also at this level where horizontal portion of the facial nerve is present. You can see here. See, this is the vestibule. This is the lateral semicircular canal. I will teach you this in future courses properly. Okay. So under this lateral semicircular canal, as you can see here, below is the facial nerve. Facial nerve is at this level. Remember at this level. Okay. Where the floor of the internal artery meatus meets the roof of the external artery meatus. And it is at the same plane where the whole window is present. If you see carefully here, we can see the stapes also. You can do both, you know, anterior and posterior pleura of the stapes and stapes suprastructure we can see here if you see carefully. So oval window is also more at same plane. Remember this plane, okay? This horizontal plane, okay? This is another tip, okay? And see, this is the plane I told you where the floor of the internal artery meatus corresponds to the roof of the external artery canal. This is external artery canal. Here, this is internal artery meatus, almost floor of the internal artery meatus. This is roof of the internal meatus. So we can see here, this is the vestibule. This is the oval window. Okay, this is the horizontal part of the facial nerve. It's running backwards. And this is the oval window. And you can see the stapes also. Remember this. okay, this plane particularly. Coming to the middle ear divisions, how do we divide the middle ear? We divide into three parts, epitympanum, mesotympanum, and hypotympanum, based on two imaginary lines, the one which passes through the roof of the eustachian canal, other one floor of the eustachian canal. Okay, so on an axial section, how do we identify these? Where we are, if you suddenly look at a particular film, ideally I advise you to study from one direction to other, either from superior to inferior or inferior to superior. But randomly, if you look at a temporal bones axial scan, see, you look at first the epitympanum. Usually in epitympanum, the ossicles are present, okay? The head of the malleus and body of the incus. Particularly this ice cone appearance will be seen. Okay, if you see the ossicles, particularly specifically in the ice cone appearance, that means you are in epitympanum, okay? Whereas if you don't see anything at all, okay, in the mesotympanum, okay, that means you are in hypotympanum, okay? This is, I'm talking about normal anatomy, okay? In pathology, we'll speak something sometime later, okay? So in a normal HRCT temporal bone, if you don't see anything in the mesotympanum, that only air is there, that means it is hypotympanum. Whereas mesotympanum, remember this two dots and two lines, okay? So in upper part of the mesotympanum, what we see is handle of the malleus and the long process of the incus, they look like two dots. Little lower part of the mesotympanum, what happens is they are little bit retracted medially. That's why they look like two lines. Okay, so if you see in mesotympanum two dots and two lines, that means you are in mesotympanum. So remember, either ice cone appearance epitympanum, air hypotympanum, two dots and two lines in mesotympanum. Okay, coming to the vestibule. Okay, remember, vestibule is the heart of the inner ear. Okay, either whether you go from anterior to posterior, lateral to the medial, it is in the middle, as you can see here. I have drawn imaginary lines. So a heart means cardiovascular system, remember. So how are the inner ear structures oriented? They oriented like a heart, a cardiovascular system. That is, cochlea is anterior, as you can see here. Okay, the semicircular canals are posterior. Okay, and vestibule is in the middle. Okay, this is how inner ear structures are oriented. That you should remember. Okay, even when you see in a coronal section, it is 1 minute. See, even when you see in, this is the axial section. Okay, as you can see, this is the vestibule. This is the semicircular canal, this is the cochlea. So even on a coronal section, you can see vestibule is in the center. Semicircular canal is in the upper part and the cochlea is in the lower part. Okay, that you should remember. Okay, cochlea is below and semicircular canals are above. Okay, that is vestibule is in the center. That you should remember. Okay, and how do we identify or differentiate cochlea from vestibule? Unless severely malformed cochlea, like common cavity or aplasia, see, usually they have a standard orientation. What you do is you draw an imaginary line parallel and middle through the interlateral meatus, as you can see here. Okay, so whatever structure is anterior and lateral to this imaginary line, red line, that is cochlea, anterior and medial. Okay, anterior medial is cochlea, whatever posterior and lateral is vestibule and semicircular canals. Okay, a parallel line passing through the middle of the interlateral meatus. Whatever anterior and medial is cochlea, whatever posterior and lateral is the vestibule and semicircular canal. This is another orientation, axial section, you should remember. Okay, so also I would like to show you the relationship of the cochlea to the vestibule. I told you cochlea is in the anterior, but actually it is not anterior, anterior inferior. Okay, this is the oval window, this is the facial canal. You can see this is the first geno will be here, second geno will be here. This is a temporal bone dissection slide, and this is the vertical part of the facial nerve. Okay, we can see the semicircular canals. We see the lateral semicircular canal, superior and posterior semicircular canal here. Okay, and here vestibule will be here where the oval window is present. As you can see here, the cochlea three turns, basal turn, middle turn, and the last turn are seen here. Okay, so cochlea is anterior, inferior, and more medial compared to the vestibule. So cochlea aims vestibule. Remember, that means cochlea is anterior, inferior, and medial to the vestibule. This relationship you should remember all the time. Okay, this will tell you this thing. So one more thing is, what are the anterior structures present? You should remember, when you look at the structure, you should orient yourselves, and you should have this this orientation. That is, I call this as mecca. Okay, what are the anterior structures of in the temporal bone? So look at in the mesotympanum anteriorly, what we have, you draw a line. Okay, to the middle of the vestibule, that is, which is serious or hard. So whatever anterior structures there, first what we see, head of the malleus, remember, M of mecca. Okay, then what we have, we also have, if you go lower down, we have the eustachian tube also, okay? That is E, okay? This is anterior to the anterior structure again. Okay, then we have the cochlea. I told you cochlea is anterior and medial. And also at lower down level, you see the carotid artery, internal carotid artery, okay? That you should remember. And also we have anterior epitympanum here in the upper part. That you should remember, okay? So MECA, all the anterior structures are, you can remember this in this mnemonic as a MECA, okay? Yeah, coming to the facial nerve, see, facial nerve is the most important thing, okay? Important structure in the middle ear and mastoid. See, if there was no facial nerve, otology specialty as such wouldn't have existed. This would have been taken over by somebody else, either general surgeons or neurosurgeons. Let me have some water. Okay, I remember a mnemonic to remember parts of facial nerve, that is, I love going to masti parties. For all friends from foreign countries, masti means having fun in Hindi, okay? Masti, okay? So I love going to funny parties or fun parties or masti parties, we call it, okay? I means intracranial. The first part of the facial nerve is intracranial, then, sorry, this one, intracranial. Next, we have labyrinthine part of the facial nerve, L, okay? And G is the geniculate ganglion. Anteriorly, you will see the branches, GSPN branch. Okay, next we have tympanic part or horizontal part. This is the second genu. Then we have the mastoid part. Then it exits in the parotid part. Remember, okay, I love going to masti parties. Intracranial part, labyrinthine part, geniculate ganglia, tympanic part, mastoid part, and parotid part. Okay, this is a dissection to show you different part of facial nerve intact here. Okay, so you can see here, this is the parotid part of the facial nerve. And this is the sigmoid sinus. This is the internal carotid artery. Internal jugular vein is here. Entire cochlea and vestibule and everything, sensory canals have been drilled away. Internal artery meatus has been opened up here. Okay, you can see here. Okay, this is the first part of the facial nerve, intracranial part. This is the intracanalicular part, which runs in the internal artery meatus, anterior superior part. Then we have labyrinthine part. You can see here. This is the labyrinthine part and the facial nerve here. You can see. Okay, yeah. Next, what we have is geniculate ganglia. This is the tympanic or horizontal part. And what we have is, next is the geniculate ganglia, second genu of the facial nerve, then the mastoid part or vertical part. Remember this relationship and parts. Okay, and also, so how do we identify facial nerve and an axial section? Okay, so we have to look from above downwards. That we are going to study in a separate, I'm going to have a separate session of only facial nerve sometime later. But at this level, preliminary, I will tell you. Okay, you look at the axial sections, in an axial section from above downwards. So the first, you see a canal here, okay? This is the internal artery meatus. Look at the fundus of the internal artery meatus. When it gets divided into two parts, okay, this is the Bill's bar, you can see here. That is a vertical bar which divides the upper part of the internal artery meatus into two parts. That is, one is anterior superior, that which where the facial nerve runs, and we have posterior superior. That is where superior vestibular nerves, it enter the vestibule here, which supplies the vestibule as well as anterior ampulla of the superior sensory canal. Okay, so you see this Bill's bar is dividing two parts, and the anterior canal which goes anteriorly here is, this is the facial nerve, remember. And the anterior to it will be the, what you see is the cochlea, that you should remember. Okay, yeah, here you can see here further a lower down cut, and this cut particularly look at, again I told you, look at this ice cone appearance just started appearing, okay, upper part of the ice cone, okay, that is where this is the geniculate ganglion, it goes backwards, okay, the facial nerve runs backwards. In a properly done axial section, it will be seen complete course of the facial nerve, this is seen running backwards, okay, so that is the horizontal geniculate ganglion and horizontal part, okay, so as we come here, clockwise direction, okay, the axial section here, so how do we identify now? The second genu and vertical part, what you do is, you look at the cochlea and the vestibule, okay? Here where we, what we have is oval window here, and here we can see the stapes. So we look at posteriorly and lateral to the vestibule here, okay? And there will be a space separating these two structures, okay? That is, this is the sinus tympani, okay? And we can also see an elevation here, pyramidal process, okay? Here behind the pyramidal process, posterior to pyramidal process, you see this translucent structure. That is the vertical second genu and vertical part of the facial nerve. Remember, the vestibule, posterior and lateral, and a sinus tympani in between, okay, and oval window at this level it will be seen. Okay, further lower down, as we go down, you can see here, this is the jugular bulb, okay? And we see lateral to the jugular bulb, we see the facial nerve running downwards. Also at this same level, you will see the last basal turn of the cochlea, last part will also be seen. That you should remember, okay? This is how we identify this thing. And on a coronal section, I borrowed from picture from Peter Sohm, this thing, because I couldn't get a specific cuts of this thing. So you look at here, how do we identify in a coronal section? So in coronal section, you look for the falciform crest, okay? Look for the falciform crest in the intraorbital meatus. It usually from the fundus, it runs backwards and divides the intraorbital meatus into two parts, superior and inferior part, and you will be able to see the labyrinthine part running, okay, in the intraorbital meatus, okay? It will be usually superior to the cochlea and anterior to superior anteriorly to the cochlea. If you can see here, this is the cochlear, two turns are seen. Now we can see the labyrinthine part of the facial nerve, and also we can see horizontal of the facial nerve. See, you remember, it goes, if you see this axial section here, the facial nerve goes here anteriorly and runs backwards from the geniculate ganglia. This relationship we should remember, it runs anteriorly and comes backwards, okay? So the genu of the facial nerve, first genu will be anteriorly and superior to this cochlea, that you should remember. Coming down here, so where do we look here in a coronal section? In the mesotympanum, you look at the ossicles and the scutum at this level, look for the vestibule and the cochlea here and the lateral sensa canal. I will show you how to identify these structures again when we deal with the coronal section. And this is the oval window, okay? Here you see under the hood of the, under the beak, you can imagine this as a swan, okay? See, this is the body of the swan, the basal turn of the cochlea, okay? And we also see here, okay, what we see here is the falciform process, okay? And this is the body, this is the head of the swan, this is the beak of the swan, and this is the horn of the swan, okay? This beak of the swan you can imagine as a lateral sensa canal. So below the lateral sensa canal, you see the translucent structure, that is the facial nerve. It is medial to the ossicles, it will be here. So when we come to the vertical part of the facial nerve, imagine it is more or less at the same level as the posterior sensa canal. See, the posterior sensa canal is vertically oriented, if you remember, okay? And in the coronal sections, because it is vertically oriented, it will be seen like a tube, okay? So it will be either more or less at the same level as the posterior sensa canal. This is the vertical part of the facial nerve, which is exiting the stylomastoid foramen. But there can be variations. Also, if coronal section is not being done properly by the radiology technician, there may be little bit variation may be there, maybe 1 or 2 millimeter anterior and posterior. So what you should do is, it may not be at the same level in all the scans, you just have to look 1 or 2 cuts anteriorly or posteriorly. That's all, okay? So remember this picture, why I showed you that picture is, see, this is the horizontal part of the facial nerve, this is the vertical part of the facial nerve, and second genu here. And this is the posterior sensa canal. You can see second genu and vertical part of the facial nerve, they're more or less in the same plane, same sagittal plane, okay? Or same coronal plane, that you should remember, okay? I'll come back and show you, okay? This relationship we should remember, okay? And the facial, coming to the facial nerve genu, remember the first genu, look at the cochlea, it is anterior and superior to the cochlea here, as you can see here, okay? This is the labyrinth part of the facial nerve, this is the horizontal part of the facial nerve starting, this is ending of the labyrinthine part, they meet little anteriorly here, okay? For the second genu, where you look for the vestibule and the oval window, look for the stapes, and at the same level you will see the pyramidal process also. So between the oval window and this pyramidal process, there usually be a sinus tympani space will be there, and you see lateral to the lateral and little posterior to the sinus tympani, there it will be the second genu and starting of vertical part of the facial nerve, okay? That relationship you should remember, okay? That way you remember very well. So this is just to show the picture, this is dissection picture showing you, this is the horizontal part of the facial nerve, this is the second genu, vertical part of the facial nerve, okay? So you can see here the relationship, see the posterior sensa canal and the vertical part of the facial nerve, second genu, more or less at the same level, same plane, okay? Coronal plane, that you should remember. You can see here, this is the posterior sensa canal and this is the third part of the facial nerve and second genu, that you should remember, okay? Coming to the important thing, what makes in the ear anatomy or temporal bone anatomy most difficult is the orientation of semicircular canals. But I have decoded that. Okay, I have made it very easy for you. Okay, so we know that we have three semicircular canal. Okay, that is we have the posterior semicircular canal vertically oriented, then we have superior semicircular canal, which is also vertically oriented, and lateral semicircular canal. Okay, so how do we study them? You look at the posterior surface of the petrous temporal bone. Okay, this is the posterior surface of the petrous temporal bone. You look at those posterior surface of the temporal bone at a lower level. Vertically oriented, whatever tube-like structure and axial section which is parallel to the posterior surface of the temporal bone is posterior semicircular canal. Remember, posterior semicircular canal is parallel to the posterior surface of the petrous temporal bone. Okay, remember, vertically oriented. Whereas this is very, you know, it is very at a lower plane. Whereas superior semicircular canal, it is at a higher plane. It is also vertically oriented. Whereas this one is perpendicular to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. Okay, this relationship, if you remember, you will never fail to identify any semicircular in the future. Okay, so posterior semicircular canal, this is parallel, this is perpendicular. So in between, we have what we have is the lateral semicircular canal, which is horizontally oriented, and it is more or less, see, it is more or less, it is parallel to the lateral surface of the mastoid of parietal bone. Okay, see, this is parallel to the parietal bone. Remember, lateral semicircular canal parallel to parietal bone. Okay, posterior semicircular canal parallel to posterior surface of the temporal bone. The superior semicircular canal at a higher level perpendicular to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. Okay, yeah. See, I want to show you one more orientation of the semicircular canals. So this is, again, I told you, the vestibule is like heart, CVS. This is in the middle of the temporal bone again, and even on sagittal section also. Okay, this is the middle ear mesotympanum. This is the posterior surface of the petrous temporal bone. It's in the middle. Okay, I am going little medial section here. This is the vestibule and where the lateral semicircular canal starts. You can see here, this is the lateral semicircular canal, which is more or less horizontal, least oriented. Okay, little angling will be there, but more or less it is horizontally oriented. Okay, whereas the superior semicircular canal, you can see here, this is vertically oriented. Okay, this is vertically oriented. It's in a more or less in a sagittal plane. And same is the posterior semicircular canal also. It is parallel to the posterior surface of the temporal bone, and this is also vertically oriented. And if you see at this level of the lateral semicircular canal, the posterior semicircular canal is at a lower level and superior semicircular canal is at a higher level. If you remember this orientation, you will never have a problem. Okay, so semicircular canal, you can see here, this is the complete, all semicircular canals are not seen. This is another picture to show you the orientation of the semicircular canals. This is two horns of the lateral semicircular canal, more or less horizontally oriented, and the posterior semicircular canal vertically oriented, but it is parallel to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. Again, here this is the vertically oriented superior semicircular canal. Complete circle is not seen because of the orientation. That you should remember, this is the middle ear. Okay, yeah, I will show you on a CT scan, an axial scan. Let me have some water. Okay, now this is the petrous temporal bone. Okay, looks like a pyramid. Okay, yeah, here this is the posterior surface of the temporal bone. See this green line. Okay, so this is the posterior surface of the temporal bone. At a higher level, we have the superior semicircular canal. You can see it is oriented perpendicular to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. It is at a higher level. When you start from above downwards reading the axial sections, this is what you encounter first. Okay, even when you go at lower level, when you see the two limbs of the superior semicircular canal, they will also be oriented, that plane is oriented perpendicular to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. So whereas here you see, okay, this is the posterior surface of the temporal bone, and this is posterior semicircular canal. Okay, and again, this is oriented parallel to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. This is at a lower level. Okay, lower level. Okay, and the lateral semicircular canal, most of you will not have problem identifying lateral semicircular canal and axial section because it looks like a typical signet ring. We call it signet ring appearance. Okay, the signet ring appearance, remember, and this lateral dome of the lateral semicircular canal, it is parallel to the mastoid here. Okay, that you should remember, the lateral surface of the mastoid. Okay, so lateral semicircular canal parallel to the lateral surface of the mastoid, here superior semicircular canal perpendicular to the posterior surface of the temporal bone, and here the posterior semicircular canal, it is parallel to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. There is one more structure here, vestibular aqueduct. I will come to that little later. Okay, yeah. Now one more orientation you should remember. When we go from lateral to medially, in a, when we are operating in a sagittal plane. So which semicircular canal we reach first? When we go from lateral to medially, this is how we go in mastoid surgeries. So for that's a one semicircular canal we reach first is lateral semicircular canal, typical signet ring appearance. Okay. Whereas the posterior semicircular canal, we see only one arch of the posterior semicircular canal. It is about 2 to 3 millimeter medial to the lateral semicircular canal, as you can see here. Okay. It's a little deeper level. See, these are not at the same level, okay, in a sagittal plane. Okay. While lateral semicircular canal is more lateral, the superior semicircular canal is more medial. Okay. See, as you can see here. Okay. And another 2 to 3 millimeter medially will be the superior semicircular canal. Remember this relationship, very important. Okay. Yeah. Now I will also show that on a dissection slide here. Okay. This is the facial nerve, second genu, horizontal part, vertical part. This is the lateral semicircular canal. Okay. 2 millimeter medially, we have posterior semicircular canal. Another 2 millimeter medial to posterior, we'll have superior semicircular canal. Okay. This orientation, if you have the sagittal plane, this thing, then it becomes identifying the lateral semicircular canal also and the CT scan easier. Okay. Then we have the two important ducts I would like to tell you about, that is vestibular aqueduct and cochlear aqueduct. Sometimes, you know, depending on the thickness of the film, they will not be seen clearly. Okay. Yeah, in some films I showed you earlier, like, you know, this one you can see here, it is clearly seen very clearly. It's very big, the vestibular aqueduct. Okay. So, but I have a mechanism to tell you, identify, I have a system to identify these ducts. Okay. Vestibular aqueduct. Okay. See, the vestibular aqueduct also, like posterior semicircular canal, it is parallel to the posterior surface of the temporal bone and it is closer to the this thing, you know, the brain matter or dura mater here. Okay. It is posterior to it. Okay. In between dura mater and the posterior semicircular canal is the vestibular aqueduct. As you can see here, it is parallel to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. And one more relationship we can remember, this is usually seen at the level of the interlateral meatus. Okay. Interlateral meatus, remember, posterior, this thing, vestibular aqueduct. And this is perpendicular to the interlateral meatus. Remember, okay. The vestibular aqueduct parallel to the posterior semicircular canal, parallel to the posterior surface of the temporal bone, but perpendicular to the interlateral meatus. Okay. Now we'll come to the cochlear aqueduct. Okay. Cochlear aqueduct, where to look for the cochlear aqueduct? Always look at the basal turn of the cochlea and look for this air bubble at the lateral end of the basal turn of the cochlea. You see this air bubble, which is nothing but round window niche, round window area. So we know that it the vestibular aqueduct, it connects basal turn of the cochlea to the posterior fossa. Okay, it connects, the it opens into the posterior fossa here. So it connects immediately medial to the round window membrane, and this canal is here. Okay, whereas this canal, unlike vestibular aqueduct, this is perpendicular to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. Vestibular aqueduct parallel to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. Okay, whereas the cochlear aqueduct is perpendicular to the posterior surface of the temporal bone, but it is parallel to the interlateral meatus. Okay, remember. Cochlear aqueduct is parallel to the interlateral meatus, member, but it is at a lower level. It is below the interlateral meatus. Okay, it runs below the interlateral meatus. Okay, it runs from posterior fossa to the round window niche area. Okay, remember this. Okay, it is perpendicular to the posterior fossa of the temporal bone, parallel to the interlateral meatus, but below it. It opens where the round window niche is here. This is the basal turn of the cochlea, round window niche, air bubble, round window niche area. Okay, remember that. Okay, this is another picture to show you. The vestibular aqueduct. Okay, this is vestibular aqueduct. I told you parallel to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. Sometimes it is very big, very clearly seen. Okay, it is again parallel to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. And whereas cochlear aqueduct, as you can see here, it is parallel to the interlateral meatus, perpendicular to the posterior surface of the temporal bone. This is opposite. Another section you can see here faintly. This is perpendicular to the posterior surface of the temporal bone, but parallel and below the interlateral meatus. This is the air bubble, the round window niche. It connects from round window niche to the posterior fossa. This relationship you should remember. You will have any difficulty in identifying the vestibular aqueduct. There is one more canal you need to remember, that is subarcuate canal, through which subarcuate artery, which is branch of labyrinthine artery, it passes in the petrous temporal bone to open into the mastoid. So that's why where do we see subarcuate artery? That is under arch of the superior semicircular canal. Okay. Yeah, this is the subarcuate artery. It is seen between below the arch of the superior septum canal, between the two limbs of the superior septum canal. Okay, so how do we say this is two limbs of the superior septum canal? See the horizontal plane of this thing. So this is the posterior substance of the temporal bone. If you pass a dry line between these two structures, this is perpendicular to the posterior of the temporal bone. That's why these are superior septum canal. These are the higher level. So under arch of the superior septum canal, we see this subarcuate canal. The importance is subarcuate artery passes it. But sometimes in trauma patients, you should be very careful. Sometimes this can be misinterpreted as the horizontal fracture of the temporal bone. That you should remember. Okay. And also this, we can also see that subarcuate artery in coronal sections, if you observe carefully in 0.65 mm cuts, if you see that, this is the superior septum canal, and below the arch of the superior septum canal from posterior fossa entering into the mastoid, you can see here below the arch. Okay. So people who have done temporal bone dissection would have identified the subarcuate artery opening into the mastoid. This is another point you should remember. Coming to the last 14th point, important point, that is great vessels. Okay. So great vessels, what we have is two great vessels we have. Okay. One is the internal carotid artery. Other one is the jugular bulb and jugular vein. Okay. You draw a line to the middle of the mesotympanum at the lower part. So whatever anterior is the carotid artery. See, in Mecca mnemonic also we learned carotid is anterior. Whatever posterior we have is, this is the jugular bulb. Okay. And again, jugular bulb is divided into, this is jugular crest divides the jugular bulb into two parts. The laterally, this is the pars venosa and this is the pars nervosa. That also we should remember. And this is a sagittal section. This is a mesotympanum and the tympanic bone. You can see this is anterior, this is posterior. We can see how the internal carotid artery ascends up. And this is genome of the internal carotid artery. It runs in the petrous part of the internal carotid artery as petrous part of the internal carotid artery. Okay, in the petrous canal. Okay, here the jugular bulb. This is the jugular fossa, and it go. This is where the sigmoid sinus comes, becomes the jugular bulb here, and descend down to the internal jugular vein. Okay, yeah, that you should remember how to identify the structure. Okay, so again we see at a lower level, at the lower line, the hypotympanum. I showed you. You draw a line in the middle to this anterior carotid and posterior. So if we see little higher up, we go little higher up at, suppose say at the round window area, the jugular will not be seen anymore. Okay, only carotid canal will be seen. That is the horizontal part of the carotid, internal carotid artery, petrous part of the internal carotid artery, which will be seen running anteriorly like a tube in an axial section. So here at this level, the jugular bulb will not be seen. Okay, if you see at the round window level, the jugular bulb, if you see, that means that is a high jugular bulb. That also we learn during congenital anatomical variations. Okay, the important fifteenth tip is that is orientation of the internal artery meatus. You all have studied this during undergraduation, postgraduation. Okay, and we know this, the relationship is that is anterior superior, that is seven up, is these seventh nerve or facial nerve poked down, or eighth cochlear nerve down, that is the anterior inferiorly. Here posterior superiorly we have the superior vestibular nerve, posterior inferiorly we have this thing. inferior vestibular nerve, and the falciform crest divides this into superior and inferior. Bilge bar divides into posterior and anterior and posterior. If you want to see them, you can also study them if possible. I showed you this axial section where the bilge bar is seen. This is this bilge bar, the vertical bar is seen, which divides into anterior and posterior part. The anterior part is okay, that is the labyrinthine part of the facial nerve passes here anteriorly, and possibly the superior vestibular nerve, it passes into the cochlea here. So we will be able to see that on a this thing also. Okay, on a coronal section also we can see here, this is falciform crest. Okay, see, Bilge bar doesn't run much backwards, but the falciform crest runs okay backwards. That you should remember. Okay, and here you can see the superior part, inferior part, you should be able to differentiate. You can see the cochlear nerve entering into the cochlea here. Okay, yeah, whereas this is the facial canal. Okay, here also you can also you can also see in a sagittal section carefully, some falciform crest is seen, but we need more thinner cuts to appreciate those structures. Okay, with this, these are the some anatomical points and tips I wanted to highlight during this part, first basic part of the this thing, my presentation. In future class, what we will do is you need to study everything in detail. So each class we will address each views. So we'll start with axial, coronal, sagittal. Then we will, one class we study only special views. Then we'll study imaging for cochlear implants and also congenital anomalies of temporal bone. and also inner ear anomalies, a separate class, inflammatory diseases like cholesteatoma, another class, tumors of the temporal bone, another class, and we'll study exclusively facial nerve. That is CT, MRI, and other whatever studies required for the facial nerve and various facial nerve disorders in other class. And otosclerosis, I don't think that needs a separate, this thing we'll see. We can club it with inflammatory disease or something. Okay. And also evaluation for vertigo and tinnitus needs a special mention. That we will do another class. I think by the time we complete the lockdown in India, more or less we can complete all the topics. If you stay with me. Okay. And if please give me
I'm going to go to the hospital.